Hello students, today we are continuing with the chapter 20, Neural Control and Coordination. So in the previous class we have discussed about the midbrain, hindbrain, reflex section, reflex arm. Today again I am going to start with the reflex section and reflex arm. So just have a look over here. The entire process of response to a peripheral nervous stimulation is, that is the nerves. As I told you that in central nervous system, or we call it as this nervous system consists of two parts, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Okay, central nervous system comprises of brain and spinal cord, and peripheral nervous system comprises of nerves which arises from the brain and spinal cord. Okay, that is cranial nerves and spinal nerves. So here peripheral nervous system include all the nerves. So that occurs involuntarily. Means these all are involuntary action without conscious effort or thought and requires the involvement of a part of central nervous system is called reflex action. So any stimulation which is involuntary, okay, and requires the involvement of central nervous system is called as a reflex action. And the nervous pathway taken by the nerve impulses, the pathway through which these nerve impulses travel, that is called as the reflex arc. Now you can better understand this by this example. See over here, stimulus, that is any change from or any message which we receive from the external environment. Suppose a hot object touched the skin. So that hot object is what? It is the stimulus. Receptor, second is the receptor, that is the skin which receives the stimulation. Okay, and skin is what? It is a sensory organ. Instead of this skin, nose, eyes, ears, tongue, whatever, these five sense organs are there. Out of these five, any can be the receptor. Okay, from sensory organs, sensory nerve receives the impulse. So impulse was generated by stimulus, received by sense organ or sensory organ, then through this sensory nerves receive the message and these nerves carry the message to the spinal cord. Now in spinal cord there is a short neuron that is called as the relay neuron. It transmits the messages from spinal cord to the motor neuron. Okay, so message which was received by sensory nerve carry the message to spinal cord. Spinal cord interpret it and then send the message through relay nerve to motor nerve. Now motor nerve, it carry the message to the effector organ where the action is to be done, and that is the muscle. And due to this, muscle contracts showing the reflex action or the response, that is the removal of that body part. So the pathway, this complete pathway is called as the reflex arc, and the complete action is called as a reflex action. Okay, so just have a look at properly. We have already discussed about the central nervous system. Now we are going to discuss about the peripheral nervous system. So just have a look over here on the board. Peripheral nervous system is divided into two parts. That is, first is somatic neural system and second is autonomic nervous system. Now one by one we'll discuss these two. Somatic nervous system or somatic neural system. It contains nerves which relay impulses from central nervous system to the skeletal muscles. Okay, that means the message is transferred from central nervous system to the skeletal muscles, which is further categorized. And these nerves, they are further categorized into these two groups. First is the cranial nerve, second is the spinal nerves. So as the name is there, cranial nerve, these arise from the brain. Okay, cranial nerves arise from brain and spinal nerves arise from the spinal cord. Now, see here, cranial nerves emerge from forebrain and brain stem. Spinal nerves, all spinal nerves are mixed, having sensory and motor fibers. fibers in equal number. They are in equal number. Okay, so next is, in human beings, 10 pairs of cranial nerves are present and 31 pairs of spinal nerves are present in the human beings. Now, second is the autonomic neural system. Autonomic or nervous system, it consists of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so here this peripheral nervous system is categorized into two: somatic neural system, autonomic nervous system, or autonomic neural system. Then the somatic neural system is further categorized into two: cranial and spinal nerves. Autonomic neural system is further categorized into two: sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Now we'll discuss about the functions of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Now here are the functions of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system, in which we are going to study about the comparison. What are the difference between the functions of sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system? So just have a look over here. The first one in sympathetic nervous system is that dilation of pupil. Pupil is present in the eye, so it helps in the dilation of the pupil. That means the size of the pupil increases. Whereas parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for constriction of the pupil. That means the size decreases. That means this dilation of pupil, it works during the dim light, and this work in the bright light. Next we talk about the second point is inhibit salivary and digestive glands. That means it inhibits the secretion of salivary and digestive glands so that these enzymes or juices are not secreted from these glands. Then parasympathetic nervous system, it stimulates digestive and salivary gland. That means the enzymes are released. Then the third is accelerates the heartbeat. Heartbeat increases due to the action of sympathetic nervous system, whereas in parasympathetic nervous system, heartbeat reduces. Then contract anal sphincter. Sympathetic nervous system is responsible for the constriction or contraction of the anal sphincter, which helps in the egestion. Okay, then it relaxes anal sphincter. Parasympathetic is responsible for relaxation of the anal sphincter. Anal sphincter is present in anus. Then blood sugar level increases. When the blood sugar increases, that means when blood sugar increases, then what will happen? Pancreas secretes glucagon hormone, which convert this blood sugar into glycogen. As a result, the blood sugar level lowers down, and for this parasympathetic nervous system, blood sugar increases, blood sugar decreases, and this decrease in blood sugar is due to the secretion or release of insulin. Next is sweat secretion increases, and over here sweat secretion is inhibited. Increased secretion from adrenal glands means adrenal glands releases the adrenaline or noradrenaline hormones, and this parasympathetic nervous system, it inhibits the adrenal secretion. Then sympathetic nervous system is responsible for relaxation of the urinary bladder, and parasympathetic nervous system is responsible for contraction and relaxation. That means both contraction and relaxation of the urinary bladder. So these are the functions in a comparative manner between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. Now students, here on the board you can clearly see the diagram of a neuron or a nerve cell. Nerve cell is called as the structural and functional unit of nervous system, and it is responsible for transmission of impulses from one organ to the other. Now just have a look at the structure. See here, this is the part which is called as the cell body or cytin. Cytin or cell body, it receives the impulses from dendrites. Dendrites are small fine branches which emerges from dendron, and dendron emerges from the cell body. So one cell body has many dendrons from which different dendrites arises. Then this cell body extend into a tubular, long tubular structure called as the axon. This axon consists of Schwann cells. Then these Schwann cells, they are covered by myelin sheath. It is the protective layer around the Schwann cell, and this myelin sheath act as an insulator. Okay, then the area or the region where myelin sheath is absent, that area is called as node of Ranvier. Now there are Schwann cells surrounding the axon covered by myelin sheath, and where myelin sheath is absent, we call it as the node of Ranvier. Axon end at the nerve ending. These are the nerve endings at the end of the axon, and these nerve endings, they are found in association or in contact with the muscles. Because whatever the impulses are received, these impulses are transferred to the muscles so that the response can be done. So now what happened? How the impulses are transferred? See them. Dendrites of one neuron are connected with the nerve ending of another neuron. So nerve ending connected to the dendrites. Then dendrites from nerve ending, message is transferred to the dendrite. From dendrite, message goes to dendron, then comes to the cell body. From cell body through axon, and then to the nerve ending. Nerve ending receives the muscles, and if muscles are not present, then to the another, from nerve endings, another dendrites receives the impulses. So in this way, a complete network of neuron is formed in our body, and the impulses are transferred in a fastest manner. Now just have a look over the diagram properly. Students, just now in the diagram I told you that axon is covered by myelin sheath, means over the Schwann cells myelin sheath is present. And the gaps where myelin sheath is absent, that portion or that gap is called as node of Ranvier. But this myelin sheath is not present in all the nerves. So on that basis, presence or absence of myelin sheath, axon is categorized into two, that is the myelinated axon and non-myelinated axon. From the name only, we can see that myelinated axon means the axon which contain myelin sheath, and non-myelinated axon shows the absence of myelin sheath. So now just have a look between the two difference. What are the differences between them? That in myelinated sheath, Schwann cells, they form myelin sheath around them. Okay, so here Schwann cells, in myelinated axon, Schwann cells, they form the myelin sheath around them. Myelin sheath is formed by Schwann cells. Whereas in non-myelinated sheath, where myelin sheath is absent, so what we say that Schwann cells does not form myelin sheath around them. Next is that the gap between the adjacent myelin sheath is called as node of Ranvier. Means myelin sheath is present, and if there is a gap between the myelin sheath, then that gap is called as node of Ranvier. But in non-myelinated axon, where myelin sheath is not present, so node of Ranvier's are also absent. So what we say that these are without nodes of Ranvier. Then myelinated axon, these are found in the spinal and the cranial nerves. These are found in the spinal and cranial nerves, and these are found in the autonomous and somatic nervous system. Okay. These are found in autonomous and somatic nervous system. are found in the nerves, which arises from the spinal cord, as well as which arises from the brain, and these are found in the nerves, which are forming the autonomous nervous system and somatic nervous system. So now here we have discussed about the types of axon on the basis of the presence or absence of myelin sheath. Now here you can see the types of neuron. Just now we have discussed the types of axon due to on the presence of myelin sheath or absence of myelin sheath. Okay, now here are the types of neurons, and this is on the basis of the number of axon and dendrites present on the nerve cell. So it is categorized into three types. The first one is called as the multipolar neuron. In multipolar neuron, we can simply differentiate this from the other neuron is that the number of dendrites are many and only one axon. Though we know that a nerve cell has only one axon, but the variation is just because of the presence of the number of dendrites. So now multipolar neuron, when we say that we just now the diagram which we have seen, in that diagram many dendrites are there. Okay, so multipolar means number of dendrites are many and one axon is there, and these you can see here they have several dendrites and an axon. An axon means one axon is there. Example, cerebral cortex. That means the neurons present in the cerebral cortex region are the multipolar neurons. Second one is the bipolar neuron. Bipolar means, here you can see the diagram. This is a short descriptive diagram for the neuron. Bipolar means that one dendrite and one axon is present. One dendrite is connected to the cell body and then one axon is passed out from the cell body. That means the neuron which consists of only one dendrite and one axon. And such type of nerve cells, they are found in the retina of the eye. Then the third one is the unipolar neuron. Unipolar neurons are the neurons without dendrites. They don't have dendrites, that is cell body is having only one axon. So here you can see they have cell body with one axon only, and such type of nerve cells, unipolar nerve cells, they are found in the embryonic stage only. After that, these get modified into bipolar or multipolar neurons. So students, now here we are going to discuss about the main outstanding properties of nerve tissue or nerve cell. And these two properties are excitability and conductivity. Because we know that nerve impulses transmits within the body or from one body part to the other body part within a fraction of second. So what is the reason behind the transmission of impulses in such a very short time? So the first property is excitability. Excitability means when the response is, or we say when the stimulus is received by the sense organ, the nerve impulse is generated. And these nerve impulses are generated in the, or we call it as they are electrical impulses generated due to the action of the stimulus. And this action is done due to the change in the potential difference. Means what is the potential difference on the nerve cell that alters? And just have a look over here, excitability. It is the ability of nerve cell to generate electrical impulses in response to stimulus by altering the normal potential difference. Whatever the normal potential difference was there, it was altered, changed due to the receival of the stimulus. Stimulus is received across the plasma membrane. Stimulus is received by the plasma membrane, and this plasma membrane transmits the stimulus to the nerve cell, and in nerve cell there is alteration of the potential difference, which helps or which makes the nerve cell or nerve tissue in an excited manner or in excited state. Then when the nerve tissue has become excited, electrical impulse has generated. Now this is to be moved forward. So the transmission of impulses is also done, and it is the another important property of nerve cell. We call it as conductivity. So nerve cell, they conduct or transmit the impulses within a fraction of second. So see over here, conductivity, ability of nerve cells to rapidly transmit the electrical impulses as a wave from the site of its origin along their length in a particular direction. Because this we already know, we have taken an example of reflex action. In that, the sense organ receives the impulses, and within a fraction of second we remove our hand. So that is what, when the sense organ receives the stimulus, that means the plasma membrane has become excited and the electrical impulse has been generated. These electrical impulses transfer from sense organ to sensory nerve, then from sensory nerve to the spinal cord, from spinal cord to the motor nerve, and from motor nerve it comes back to the effector organ, that is the muscles. So this is following a particular path. So this path is followed, that is in one direction. So once again, just have a look over here, the two outstanding properties of nervous tissue. First is excitability, that the ability of nerve cells to generate electrical impulses in response to stimulus by altering the normal potential difference across the plasma membrane. Second is the conductivity. Conductivity is the ability of nerve cells to rapidly transmit the electrical impulses as a wave from the site of its origin along their length in a particular direction. So these are the two main and important outstanding properties of nerve tissue.